Hello everybody, glad you could make it. My name is Kaylee Allen and welcome to this week's video. I get asked all the time, you know, Kaylee, we know that you mainly do rare houseplants because it's kind of true, but tell me, what are your favorite common houseplants? Like if you could just have your house full of houseplants and they were all common, what would you go for? What are your favorites? So I thought today it would be really fun to completely switch it up on this channel and do a video all about my favorite common houseplants. I've had a lot of these plants before in the past, so if you've seen one of my like super old videos back from when I started my channel, you might recognize a few, or you might hear a few things that I say and be like, yeah, that makes sense, you love that. Before we get into this video, I would really appreciate it if you could hit that subscribe button and give the video a thumbs up to let me know that I'm doing a good job. And if you'd like to see any more of my content, then please feel free to check out my channel. There is a boatload of content on there and it's all organized in playlists for you to enjoy. One more thing before we get into this video today. Now, I have a couple of the plants that I'm going to talk to you about today. However, they are up in the studio and I am downstairs and I can't actually bring them all down by myself because it is a ladder to get me down. So I'm going to use photographs or where applicable, I'm going to use videos of the plants I'm talking about. As I say, I own some of them I don't anymore, but I really want to. Actually, because I really miss them. Another reason why this video is particularly cool for me is because when I next move house, I'm probably not going to put any rare houseplants in it. I will keep what I have currently. Obviously, I do have a couple of things at the flat, but generally speaking, I really want to fill my house with just the more hardy, easy stuff where if I'm not there, I can kind of replace them. Okay, let's just get right into it. I have my phone here with all the plants on it. And I would say this was a top 10, except honestly, there is more than 10 in here. So let's just kick it off with vining plants. I haven't really categorized this, but never mind. Honestly, my number one favorite trailing houseplant, like without any doubt, if I could have one, it is without a doubt the heartleaf philodendron. Now, I've still got one of these at the flat. I've had it, oh my gosh, I've had it so long, actually. I think I had it since more or less I moved to Manchester. I think when I bought it, I will have an old picture on my Instagram somewhere, and it must have had, I don't know, vines maybe this long. I don't have a photograph of it right now, but the vines are easily as tall as me, and I'm 5'4". So it's pretty good. I've had it a long time. It needs a new pot, but it's doing very, very well. I just love these plants, guys. They look jungly, but it's still nice because they have a heart shape. And honestly, you cannot go wrong with these plants. They are so tough as well. The amount of times I've nearly killed one of these things because at home they're not in self-watering pots. It's up there. Trust me, it's up there. So it's absolutely one of my favorites. I would probably have multiple of these in a house because it is my favorite trailing philodendron, even more so than the next one I'm going to mention, actually, which is the philodendron micans. Now, that is also a very, very gorgeous philodendron. It's just not as tough as the, you know, the original good old green. I do still have the one that I had ages ago in my flat as well. Now, they both get underwatered quite a bit because obviously I'm not there so often, but the micans does not react very well to it, whereas the heartleaf is, it's easier to deal with. So if you want one of those, obviously one is more easy to find than the other. I would class everything in this video, at least where I am from in the world, which is the UK, as common. So you can find, you know, heartleaf philodendron, you can find philodendron micans. But honestly, I think they're absolutely amazing. If I had to choose one, it would still be the original heartleaf. But the micans is definitely up there. If I could have two, obviously I would have both. And I'm blessed to have both. And I really appreciate them. And they've stayed with me my entire journey. So I'm really, really proud of those. But if I could start all over again with common houseplants, they would absolutely, absolutely be in the list. So I have some more vining plants that I absolutely love. One of them is behind me. And I can't remember exactly what plant it is. It's a Skindapsus pictus. Why can't I say that today? I think it's my Invisalign. So there's two, you just can't see the other one. Yes, I know it's always thirsty, right? On every single video, every single report where someone can see it, they're always like, yo, please, I love you, but please water that plant. And I do water it. It just gets missed a lot when it gets watered because it's hanging and it's not in a self-watering pot and it's in soil and it gets fed differently and yada, yada, yada. But I think very shortly, I have two of them. I'm going to plant them both together in a self-watering pot and have them flourish in my studio. So I'm going to save it. It's going to be all good. I'm going to combine it and this shouldn't happen anymore. I don't think I ever had one of these way back in the day. I think I had a silver and pothos. loss, which I don't know why they call it that, because I'm pretty sure it is also skin depthus, I believe. I think I had one of those. I don't know if it died or I sold it. I might have sold it because way back then when I was collecting rare plants, they kind of took over. And my logic at the time was, well, I'll just get rid of some of the common ones because I can get them back at a later date. Whereas if I get rid of the rare ones, then I can't, if you know what I mean. So a lot of the time, unfortunately, a lot of the common plants went. But honestly, they're both absolutely iconic and I love them because the silveriness and the feel of the leaves is just awesome. I tell you what, you're going to hate me. You're going to be real annoyed, but I'm going to go grab it and I'm going to show it to you since it is here. Yeah, it's thirsty. I do know this. It's very thirsty. I've watered it yesterday, actually, and it was so thirsty that it still hasn't improved. So I've watered it again literally just this morning. It should look amazing. It doesn't. It will the next time you see it, I promise you. I'll give you an update. Along with that, I have the Marble Queen Epipremnum. Now, I like Epipremnum, but not as much as Skindapsis. I feel like Skindapsis are a little bit prettier to me. So the Epipremnum Marble Queen, which I do have upstairs, it's gorgeous. It's not as white anymore, actually. I have a little bit on the wall. I think I could see a little piece of it kind of here and there. Kind of filming in a new location, by the way. Let me know if you like it. I thought I'd change it up a little bit today. Generally, the Epipremnum Marble Queen Pothos is really, really nice because I feel like it's kind of like variegation on a budget and it grows really easy. So I feel like you could really brighten a space with it and basically not worry about your wallet. So that's absolutely another favorite viner as well. Are we out of viners now? Yes. So I have some ferns to talk about today. Again, keeping with the common theme, just the ferns I love the most. I've had every single one of these ferns and I still have one of them now upstairs. Obviously, it's a new one. It's not the old one. So the first fern, which is not a fern, actually. Did someone tell me once it wasn't a fern? You'll have to forgive my knowledge there. I'm not totally clued up. If you know what it actually is, then please feel free to write a comment. I won't take offense. The first one I want to talk about is the asparagus fern. And honestly, I don't know what it is about this fern, but I love it. If you've never touched one before and you're in a garden center, I implore you to go up and touch it. And it might make you want to buy it because it's like this beautiful, soft. I mean, I would describe it like fur, but I feel like that would freak people out. And it's not really like fur, but it's just so soft and nice. And you can kind of wiggle it and it's all bushy and it's just lovely. It's a lovely, lovely fern. I remember when I picked up my first fern years ago, I picked it up from London and I agonized over this fern for like, oh, I don't know, like 20 minutes picking out the perfect fern, the perfect plant. We've all been there. We've all been there. We've all held up two plants going this one or this one. What about this pot? What about this pot? Back then, my life was very much like that when I went shopping and I picked up this fern and I loved it because it looked like a little tree out of like a Tolkien book and I absolutely adored it. And I still feel the same way about that fern. I feel like it's almost reminiscent of a bonsai tree. I just think it's the most beautiful thing you can have, honestly. Again, probably not a fern, but it's beautiful. And if you haven't touched one before, I mean, gently, go and touch one in a plant shop and honestly, see if you like it because it's so pretty. I also find it's very easy care and I've been doing something with mine recently. I moved it and it's insanely happy now. I will share with you what that is when I do an update video for you guys on Tuesday of the studio upstairs. I will share with you what I've been doing in terms of like I've changed where it is and it's thriving. So that's another one that I absolutely love. Second to that, I've got the crocodile fern because that is a fantastic fern that just looks so different from any other fern to me personally. It's also incredibly easy care compared to a lot of other ferns. Like a lot of people, when they think of ferns, they think of like the Boston fern, which is like, look at it and you will die. If you look at it wrong, it will die. You will die. It's generally a bad day. But the crocodile fern is a really nice fern. And of course it gets its name because it looks like crocodile scales. So that's a really nice one as well. So if you're looking for a fern that's a little bit different and you didn't happen to know about the crocodile fern, try and get one online. Now, I haven't really seen them too often in garden centers, but I know they are available and you can get them. The next thing I have, sorry, I'm typing in my document, is the blue star fern. Now, I love these. I don't think I ever had one previously, and I got some for the living wall. You may remember it when I built this, you know, the living wall that is off camera. I had a big blue star on either side of the living wall, and I knew when I put them in there that it was a little bit of a gamble to see if it liked the lecker. Long story short, it hated it. Both of them just rotted, just died. It wasn't very nice. By contrast, I think I had one upstairs and it dried out. So I don't class it personally, in my experience, has been a very tough fern. It's definitely another fern that I would love to put in my house. I would absolutely love to have one of those again. And I will in the future. I just think in this shop, it's probably not going to work for me. Monstera deliciosa. There's only one Monstera Deliciosa. If I could have it in my house, there is no doubt in my mind. It has to be the Monstera Deliciosa large form. This plant does something. It does something to my heart. I absolutely adore it. This plant is fantastic. It gets leaves. I mean, I'm looking at mine now. It's like a meter from the camera. It's very sexy. The leaves, honestly, right now are about that wide. That's about 2 feet wide. And they're about nearly 3 feet tall. That's how big the leaves are, literally like this. Huge, huge leaves. They're absolutely beautiful. And I love these plants because they size up so fast. And if you've got the space and you don't mind maybe doing a little bit of a repaint of your wall afterwards, then they're absolutely fantastic because they will take over, but it will look like an actual jungle in your house. I think the day that I buy a house for sure, I will absolutely get one and I will have a spot in like a big white corner of, you know, like a living room or something. And I'm just going to let it go nuts. Seriously, Monstera Deliciosa large form is great. Now, very quickly, it's not just any old Monstera Deliciosa you can buy from a shop, because a lot of them are what used to be known as Monstera Borzigiana, which is now simply known as small form. A lot of people do still call it Borzig or Borzigiana, but generally it's small form. That Monstera tends to be sold on a pole and it vines up, and the vines have quite large spaces between the petioles of the leaves. Or if you're buying a young one, it's probably definitely still small form as well. If it's in a little pot and the leaves are only like this and they haven't fenestrated yet, 9 times out of 10, that's not large form. Large form is a little bit harder to get, but honestly, you can find it in some garden centers. You just have to kind of know what you're looking for. Maybe I can go out in the field and see if I can find one. That could be quite fun, actually. Right, after that huge rant about Monstera Deliciosa, okay. The next kind of section I want to talk about of things that I would absolutely love to put in my house. Seriously, if anyone has ever wondered whether my love for these plants have gone, they absolutely haven't. It's one of my favorite houseplants. I just find them really high maintenance and I don't have the time to maintenance them at the moment. I'm lumping in this category the Calathea family and the Stramanthi family. Now, really, there's only really one Stramanthi that I love. I used to own two different ones, but there's only really one I want to talk about. And I do have one upstairs and it's huge, if you guys remember. The Stramanthi Sanguini Trio Star is unbelievable if you want a plant with pink on it that's variegated and it moves and everything like that. Because I don't know if everybody knows this, but the Calathea, the Maranta, and the Stramanthi family, there's probably more like Tananthi and stuff like that. They move their leaves at, you know, morning and night. That's why they're called prayer plants. So during the day, the leaves are like this, right? That's how the plant hangs. And at night, they should fold up like that in prayer. A lot of people don't know that. And I think sometimes they buy the plant and they think it's wilting and dying. It's not. It's supposed to do that. And it does that when it's happy, actually. It folds really well when it's happy. So that's a good thing if you've got those. But honestly, the Stramanthi Trio Star is my favorite Stramanthi. It's really the only Stramanthi I'd probably keep. Calathea, honestly, there are so many Calathea I'd keep. If you remember me from back in the old days, I was obsessed with them. I still am. And believe me, when I get a house, they're all coming back. Like, every single one of them are coming back. In terms of Calathea, I wrote down the Orbifolia and the White Star. And I think there's Warswickii. I can't say it. I can't remember how to say it. But there's three plants that came to mind like straight away. Orbifolia is a beautiful jungle plant. I actually think it goes really well with an Aroid collection because it does look a little bit paddly and I think it blends in really nice. The White Star is absolutely stunning. If you haven't seen that, I will obviously have put a picture in because it's unbelievable. Very, very nice plant. So any of those Calathea I would have. There are tons of different Calathea that I liked, but I never got to own. One of them was the Calathea Flame Star, I think it was known. That was a very beautiful one. There's so many, and I still love Calathea so much. I love prayer plants. I'm all about them. Which brings me on to my next category, which is the, of course, the Maranta. Now, I love these so much that I had to bring these back. And I have technically three upstairs, but it's not really visible what it is yet. So I have upstairs the Lemon Lime Maranta, which is really cool, by the way, because you can't really get them in Britain. So technically in Britain, that's probably not rare, but very uncommon, I would say. But in America, you can get them all the time. And I think Netherlands, you can get them too. Now, I do have another Maranta up there that is rare, so I won't really talk about it. It's Maranta Silver Band. And then I have a Maranta, like, no ID up there as well, which really isn't growing well. I don't know what's the matter with that. But I still have him, guys. I have Gus. Now, so many people ask me for updates on Gus. I don't have any for you right now because I'm at the shop. Gus is doing very, very well. He's very cute. He's living his best life. I haven't got rid of him. He's had a pretty severe haircut, though. At one point, he got a very severe underwatering. He grew in the dark a little bit, so he had some really small foliage. So I've, like, chopped him right back, and I'm growing him out. I'm growing him out now in a self-watering pot in a much brighter place with some... I think Maranta no ID as well. I've got a little bit at home. So he's fine. I just can't really show you a picture right now. I'll try and whop out an older picture, as well as I will have already shown you probably the lemon lime as well, because that's upstairs and it's great. I love Maranta generally. I just think they're so awesome. Honestly, it was my first plant that I ever bought that did something. It was the first plant I bought that moved. So it will always hold a special place in my heart. And it absolutely will come with me when I move house. I have one alocasia on this list. I have owned many, don't get me wrong, but this is the one I would actually take if I could have one alocasia in another house. If I could start all over again and I had the space, because that is kind of key. I picked one alocasia, and it's probably not the one you think I'm going to say. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. You might remember it, though. This would be the alocasia calidora. I used to have one of these. I called him Big Al because he wasn't even big at the time, to be fair. He was like 2 foot high. But I called him Big Al because he was a big alocasia. And since working in the shop, I now have true understanding of what a large houseplant is. So I wouldn't say he was that large, even though he was called Big Al. But I like him because I've actually seen a lot of pictures on Instagram recently of what appears to be Alocasia calidora. And for a lot of people, they're probably not special at all. Honestly, they're probably not. They're all green. But they reach really good size. The petiole to leaf ratio on them is actually very good, because if you've got things like, I can't really grab it now, Alocasia zebrina, for example, or I have a reticulata that's like, where is it? I can't do this backwards. It's actually right here. The petiole to leaf ratio on that, it's like a long, thin petiole and then like an arrow-shaped leaf. The calidora is more chunky and it has a big paddly leaf. It's a little bit more like a philodendron giganteum looking thing. And it grows and it gets to be of really beautiful size. It sizes up really nicely. And I just find when you see those really aesthetic pictures on Instagram where it's like, it's all interior designed and then there's like a corner and it's just got this absolute just beast in the corner, this big green thing. I think it looks fantastic. And whenever I've gone on holidays, like I think when I last went to Thailand, there was loads of calidora just growing out the ground, and they were absolutely huge. We're talking like the trunk was like this, you know what I'm saying? It was huge, and I really like that vibe. Last thing I want to talk about on this list, this has actually changed for me slightly from seeing this at my parents' house and from having two of them here, actually. I want to talk about palms real quick, and it will be really quickly, because I would have said a long time ago that my favorite palm to have in the house would probably be an areca palm. I think it's called an areca palm. Now, I've changed my mind because I saw the Kentia palm. It's much nicer. I prefer the fronds on that to the areca palm. The Kentia, it's much thicker and the blades that come out, they're a lot wider. And I feel like that looks a little bit more tropical. And I think it's more of a statement. And I think that's actually come from my love. This is going to sound really weird, but I feel like that's come from my love of Monstera because of the big, you know, that big vibe. So I think palm-wise, it would be maybe not even one, maybe a couple of Kentia on either side of like a door or I don't know. It's going to be very fun the day I get a house. Seriously, guys, it's going to be wild because I'm going to have so much fun just putting huge plants everywhere. I think for me, generally, I prefer less plants, but big plants to lots of little plants. Like, I'm not someone that can have a ton of pots lined up on a windowsill. Now, there's nothing wrong if you do that, but for me, I don't really like it. I like very minimal spaces. I like to have a clean mind. I don't like clutter. I'm one of those people. So for me, I would rather go larger plants and less of them. I think that's probably how I've evolved in terms of my plant taste, I would say. When you see my tour next week, you may see that a few things have been removed from the room. Either they live down here, or I think maybe one or two of them might have died. Yeah, because I had a blue star fern that used to be up there, and that's dead now. Maybe you might think it's more minimal, maybe you won't. I can't remember what the tour looked like. So thank you very much for just having a little chat with me about, you know, what I would do if I could do it all again without rare plants, because I do get asked that. Honestly, I get asked that all the time. Thank you very much for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you like this video, then please leave a like down below. It lets me know that I'm doing a good job making content for you guys to enjoy. And similarly, if you'd like to see any more of my content, then please feel free to hit that subscribe button. Go and have a look at my channel. It's all laid out. Thank you very much, guys, and I will see you very soon, actually, in the next few days. Bye.